It is possible to approximate when a solar eclipse will happen again, the same way we approximate values for pi. I'm actually in Argentina, and behind me, the moon is moving in front of the sun. It's hard to see from the camera over there, but I have a second camera here. And if I zoom into the sun while covering it with a solar filter, you can see, it'll take a second to come into focus, that the moon is pretty much, come on, there it is, look at that. So there's just a tiny crescent of the sun as the moon has almost completely covered it. So I'm gonna leave that filming down there. So if we're having a total solar eclipse now, when will it happen again? So it's happening at the moment because the moon is coming exactly between the Earth and the sun. Even though the moon is a lot smaller than the sun, it is a lot closer. So I've actually brought a scale model of both the sun and the moon. So my wife Lucy, who is a solar physicist and overqualified to hand me a cardboard sun. Does it look accurate? Is that about right?
Yeah, yeah, sort of a blank disc.
Blank disc. It's
blank yellow disc.
It's a very quiet solar cycle at the moment, isn't it? Okay, so this is not to scale, by the way. The moon is actually 400 times smaller than the sun. This is 4 times. This is a quarter. So this is a 100 times too big moon. But we're going to do a 4-to-1 instead of 400-to-1. And normally the sun is 400 times further away than the moon. So we're going to do 4. So actually I've got a measuring tape there. So if you, actually, do you want to take the end of the tape?
Okay.
And I'll give you the moon.
Okay.
And so I'm going to take the sun 4 meters back, and Lucy's going to put the moon 1 meter. Hang on. 4 is here. And well, actually, if we put the, actually, let go of the tape. All right, and then we pop that out of the way. So from the, there's a lot of people getting very excited about the clips over there. So from the point of view of the camera, the, actually Lucy, you can just leave that where it is in the air. So perfect, right. And so from your point of view, that should be the same size as, actually, I'm just gonna leave that there as well. They should be the same apparent size from where you're looking. And we get an eclipse each time the moon perfectly lines up, which is almost, but not quite, happening behind me. I'm getting very excited. Not as excited as they are, but you get the idea. This will happen again when the moon has continued around its orbit and eventually come back in the same alignment. Now, I did a video a few years ago about this, and it's always more complicated than that. So I'm going to leave a link to my old video in the description below. You can see all the finer details of the chaos that are orbits in our solar system. This time, I'm going to approximate it. I only care about 2 orbits for the moon. There's the amount of time the moon takes to go from between the sun-Earth line to come back in there again. That's the synodic month, so how long that takes. But because the orbit of the moon isn't perfectly in alignment with the kind of sun-Earth plane, actually is on an angle, so it comes up through the plane and back down through it, and that happens every, that is just over every 27 days. And that is the nodical month. So the nodical month is just over 27 days. The synodical month, or the synodic month, is 29 and a half days. They're different values. And we get another eclipse the next time we've had a whole number of both of them. So we have to find 2 integers where if you multiply the synodic month by 1 integer and the nodical month by the other integer, you get the same answer. And actually, last night I was talking to Destin from Smarter Every Day. We had dinner because there are a lot of people in the area enjoying the eclipse. He's somewhere else filming it. And I was explaining all this to him, and he goes, well, would you say if you didn't use any math, what you're trying to explain is if you had a pendulum, let's say, that's swinging backwards and forwards to represent the moon coming between the sun-Earth line, and a second pendulum with a different period going up and down for it to going up and down through the sun-Earth plane, you just want to know how long it takes until they come back perfectly in phase. I'm like, well, yes, but now you've taken all the math slash fun out of it. I want to do it with a rational approximation of an irrational number. And that's exactly what we do with pi. So for the case of the moon, we get 2 attempts every nodical month because it goes down and then back up. We get 1 attempt every synodical month. So a synodical month divided by half a nodical month gives us a value of just over 2. It's 2.17 blah, 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 blah. If we want to approximate that, we can do what we do with pi. We use a continued fraction. So pi as a continued fraction equals 3 plus 1 over 7 plus 1 over 15 plus 1 over, and so on, so on, so on, all the way down. And each time you go one step further, you get a bit more precision, and technically it goes on forever. You can't represent pi perfectly in a finite fraction. But if we just take a finite bit, if we go down as far as we're prepared to before we get bored, that will give us a very good approximation. So the very first one, 3 plus 1 over 7, that's the classic 22 over 7. If we go one term further and then simplify it, that gives us 303 over 106, one of my favorite approximations for pi. If we go one more, that gives us the semi-famous 355 over 113 approximation. We can do the same thing with the orbit of the moon, and I actually worked these out. So I think Lucy is going to pass me her book. Are you going to go watch the eclipse? How long have we got?
You've got about 5 minutes, so...
Loads of time, loads of, please.
Right, I'm heading over here.
You do that. I'm going to read some numbers out to a camera. Yes, I have traveled halfway around the world to read you fine people some numbers. Okay, so the continued fraction for the ratio of the different months, if we're using half of a nautical month, is the values are 2, 5, 1, 6, 1, 1, 1, 1, 11, and we don't need all of these. We're going to start at the top, work our way down. It will generate a series of rational approximations, and if you do this with a continued fraction, you're guaranteed to get an approximation which is better than any approximation with an equal or smaller denominator. It doesn't guarantee you you'll get all such approximations, but each one you get is definitely the best for that size. And so when's the first one that looks like it's all right? So 13 on 6, that's reasonably close. So that is 6 synodical months, which is 177.18 days. I looked it up. Sure enough, in 177.18 days from now, 26th of December, 2019, that's our 2000 day wedding anniversary, 26th of December. Yeah, we can celebrate. There is a solar eclipse. It's annular. What are you going to do? But it lines up, right? And so because that approximation is roughly, you get the same number, the same time period, if you multiply them with different integers, sure enough, you get another eclipse. Next one, 89 over 41, 1,210.75 days. That's the 25th of October, 2023. That's an eclipse. And if you carry on through these approximations, right down to the Saros one, which I talked about last time, if you take 223 of the synodic months, that's 6,585.32 days, just over 18 years. Sure enough, 13th of July in 2037, there'll be another eclipse. And so it works. And so if we ignore all the complications, at least on a human life time scale, this way of approximating an irrational number with a rational fraction will give you a very good indication of when you're going to get them. Not where on the Earth, because the Earth will spin different amounts depending on, because it's not an exact number of days, but you can work all of that out. Okay, so now this is dangerously close to being...
It's really getting dark.
It's genuinely getting dark. I should, speaking of a human lifetime, you don't get to see many of these. So I'm going to go and actually see the solar eclipse, which is happening right now. I'll be right there. Thank you so much for watching these videos. Thank you, Patreon supporters. You've made this happen. I really appreciate it. And given I've given up the decent amount of enjoying a solar eclipse, make sure you like, subscribe, turn on the notifications. I can't believe I'm saying this during an eclipse. I'm out of here. Thank you for watching the videos. Links in the description for lots more maths. Have fun. sorry. Hey, it's Future Matt here from the edit. There's a couple things I wanted to add. Firstly, as some of you may have noticed, the lens flare on my camera was giving us a constant update of the current state of the eclipse. So instead of a normal like disc sun in the lens flare, we got a crescent sun. Incredible. Also, I spoke to Destin since the eclipse. We had a chat and he sent me the footage he took. So this is his zoomed in on the sun camera feed. And in a moment, oh, there it goes. Once we hit the eclipse, you can see much more clearly what's happening. So most of the sun's now blocked out. There's a bright bit of light on the side. That's because
The moon is not a perfect sphere. It's got mountains. And as the very last valleys pass over the surface of the sun, we will then go into the full eclipse, which is happening about now. There we go. Ah, incredible. In fact, even in my camera at the top there, you can see we're in the eclipse. Well, one thing I noticed afterwards, I didn't see at the time, is if I rapidly fast forward and rewind during the eclipse, you can see the shadow of the moon going backwards and forwards across the screen. So anyway, I highly recommend you go and see an eclipse if you get a chance. Make sure you do check out Destin's full video over on Smarter Every Day. And if you've already seen it, and in fact that's why you're watching my video, and you like mathematics, don't forget to subscribe.